Praise the Lord. I said, praise the Lord. I welcome every one of you to the Bible study tonight in Jesus' name. I pray it will be an enriching time together as we look at the Word of God and study together. Would you rise up as we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you very much for bringing us together. Thank you for the faithfulness of your people, always coming, always listening, always learning. And Lord, we pray that what we listen to and learn today will be of tremendous benefit to everyone in Jesus' name. We know the Lord is coming again, and we pray, Lord, you prepare every one of us to be ready, that none of us will be left behind in Jesus' name. We know that those who are left behind will go through a terrible time of the great tribulation under the reign of the Antichrist. What a weeping and what a suffering that will be for them, Lord. None of us will be there at that time in Jesus' name. Open our eyes to see what we need to see, and move our hearts to take the right decision, so that we live for the glory of your name. And when that time comes, the Lord will appear in the sky to call his own people home. Lord, when the saints go marching in, we'll be part of them. Bless everyone here tonight, and all our brothers and sisters who are listening everywhere as they fellowship with us around the study of the word. Bless them together with us in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. You can do better than that. Thank you very much. You can see now, we're looking at Daniel tonight. We have been in Daniel now for a number of months, and the Lord has been enriching our lives. Tonight we're looking at Daniel chapter 11. And we're going to study from verse 21 to verse 45. What a passage this is. I'm going to read some selected verses of scripture as we look at this together. Verse 21. And in his estate shall stand up a vile person, to whom they shall not give the honor of the kingdom, but he shall come in peaceably and obtain the kingdom by flatteries. That already tells you something. Number one, this is prophetic, because it uses the future tense in its estate, shall stand up a vile person. And then it talks about his receiving the kingdom. And then it says, he'll receive that kingdom, it will not be given to him, but he'll come in peaceably, and he'll obtain that kingdom by flattery. Look at verse 23. And after the lead mage with him, he shall work deceitfully. Again, as you see the word shall, that's referring to the future. He shall work not faithfully, not truthfully, not honestly, but deceitfully. For he shall come up and he shall become strong with a small people. Again, this is predicting that this king that will come, when he comes, he's going to manifest a kind of unprecedented power. He'll appear small at the beginning, but then as he grows, he's going to be really mighty and strong. In verse 24, and he shall enter peaceably, even unto the farthest places of the province, and he shall do that which his fathers have not done, nor his fathers' fathers. He's telling us he's going to prevail so much, and he's going to have so great power, that even the military geniuses before him, like his forefathers, they wouldn't have got such a victory. And then it says, he shall scatter among them the prey and the spoil and the riches, yea, and he shall forecast his devices against the strongholds, even for a time. That tells us that latter part, even for a time. That means that his reign will not be forever, and his ruling will not be everlasting. It's just for an appointed time, a period of time, even for a time. We're looking at verse 31. In verse 31 it says, and their hands shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength. It all comes to his religious possession, and to the perversion of his heart. He says he will pollute the sanctuary, that when he comes eventually, he will even defile and destroy the worship of the living God. And he shall take away the daily sacrifice. The thing is getting worse and worse, because first of all, it defiles, it desolates that place, and they're not able to worship again. He even cancels the daily sacrifice of the Jewish people, and they shall place the abomination that maketh desolate. The first part of verse 32. And such as do wickedly against the covenant shall be corrupt by flatteries. As we have read all these verses, you see the mode of operation of this vile person and this Satan controlled personality that will come. Look at verse 36. And the king shall do according to his will, and he shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god, and shall speak marvelous things, wonderful things, terrible things, blasphemous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper. That he is to prevail at that time till the indignation be accomplished, for that is determined shall be done. And then in verse 37, it says, neither shall he regard the gorge of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. You begin to have a feel of this personality coming, this prince coming, this king coming, that is the Antichrist actually. He will not regard the Almighty God, because he will stand in the temple of God, making himself and arrogating such authority unto himself. Because of that, there will be no respect in his heart for any God. Verse 41. He shall enter also into the glorious land, that he shall enter into the land of Israel. The people of God will have a fear of the power, the pressure, and the terrible force that he will bring upon them. And many countries shall be overthrown. That tells us then that the rule of the Antichrist, this vile person, this son of perdition, this one that is coming, his rule will not be limited to the children of Israel, to the land of Israel, because it says many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall escape out of his hand, even Edom and Moab and the chief of the children of Ammon. We're looking at verse 45. And he shall plant the tabernacles of his palace between the seas in the glorious holy mountain. Here comes the end, yet he shall come to his end. That Antichrist will come to his end. It will not be forever, because the King of Kings shall come, and the Lord of Lords will appear. And when he appears, he's going to destroy the power of that vile person. It says, yet he shall come to his end, and none shall help him. As we look at Daniel, we're coming to the end of the book of Daniel. And for us to just look back to the things we've learned and see how special, how peculiar, how precious, both to the people of the Old Testament and the people of the New Testament, Daniel was. Look at the prophetic inspired words of Daniel. Daniel's inspired writing did not only record history, it also revealed prophecy. And the revelation of prophecy through Daniel was not limited to Israel. The great events concerning the major Gentile kings and kingdoms were revealed in great and minute details. Already we studied in chapter 2, he spoke about Babylon, he spoke about Medo-Persia, he spoke about the Grecians, he spoke about the Romans. And so you understand that his ministry extended towards the Israelites on the one hand, and also towards the Gentile kingdoms on the other hand. Some of the prophets in the Bible days, their predictions and prophecies were fulfilled only a few years after their ministry. Or maybe some of them only a few decades after their ministry and lifetime. Some of them only a few centuries, hundreds of years after their ministry and lifetime. In the case of Daniel, it's very different. His prophecy spans a very long period, from the time when he prophesied in Babylon until the end of time, until the end of the world. And if you examine the prophecies of Daniel, some of those prophecies were fulfilled immediately. Like when he prophesied that very night Belshazzar will be slain, that prophecy became fulfilled within one day, within one night. In some other cases, you'll find that his prophecy was fulfilled about a few months, 12 months actually, about 1 year after he prophesied. You remember when he prophesied that Nebuchadnezzar was going to be turned to an animal, and it was going to eat grass like an animal. That was fulfilled 12 months after. Yet some others were fulfilled hundreds of years after, because he spoke about the coming of the Medo-Persian Empire. That took some years, and then the Grecian Empire, that took some years, and the Roman Empire, that took some hundreds of years before they came. And then he spoke about Christ being born, about the Messiah, and then that Messiah will come, and the Messiah shall be cut off. That actually happened some hundreds of years after. He spoke about Christ coming the first time, and he spoke about Christ coming again the second time. Has Christ come the second time? No, he has not come the second time. And so part of that prophecy of Daniel then, which is referring to the time he will still come in the future, that is still to be fulfilled. He spoke about the Antichrist, and he spoke about the covenant he will have the children of Israel. He spoke about the abomination of desolation that he will erect, he will affirm in the land of Israel at that time. That has not been fulfilled yet. That is still to come. In fact, as we look at the prophecies of Daniel, he goes right on to the very end of time. Look at Daniel chapter 11. In Daniel chapter 11, verse 35, and some of them of understanding shall fall, to try them, and to purge, and to make them wise, even to the time of the end. To the time of the end, because it is yet for a time appointed. You see how significant the prophecy of Daniel was. He prophesied, and his ministry actually spanned the whole of the period of that time till the time of the very end. Let's look at Daniel chapter 12. In Daniel chapter 12, we're looking at verse 4. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. You see that again, that Daniel knew he was prophesying not only to the people of his own time, he was prophesying also for the people of the time still to come. Verse 7, and I heard the man clothed in linen, which was upon the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand and his left hand unto heaven, and swear by him that liveth forever and ever, that it shall be for a time and times and a half, 3.5 years of the great tribulation. So, and that is still future. And you see then that he prophesied about things yet to come. Look at verse 9. And he said, go thy way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed till the time of the end. That means then Daniel was very significant, significant among all the prophets of the Old Testament. In fact, even among the prophets of the New Testament too. Daniel's ministry is relevant to Israel, and his ministry is relevant to all the nations of the world. Important and instructive at his own time, and also at our own time. As we study this, I don't want you to just get a theory of what we're studying and say, what a wonderful man Daniel was. Think about yourself and think about our church as well. We have just learned that the ministry of Daniel was profitable, was important, was very instructive to the people of Israel and to the people that were not Israelites. You think about your life. Is your life profitable to people around you and the people beyond you? Is your life serviceable to the people around you, the people that look like you, and the people that are not looking like you? They don't talk the way you talk, they don't speak the language you speak, they don't dress the way you dress. The people outside your territory, outside your community, are you useful unto them? In the case of Daniel, his ministry was profitable to the Jews and to the Gentiles, enlightening, encouraging, and strengthening to the early church and to the end time church, to the young and to the old, to the people that began the race and to the people that are now ending the race. And our prayer is that our lives and ministries will touch other people, will transform other people, will teach other people beyond our locality, beyond the period of our lifetime. If that is going to be so, it will mean that you'll be looking beyond yourself. You'll be looking beyond your locality. Think about us as individuals. Think about us as a family, your own family. Is your family touching other people beyond your local circle, beyond your comfort zone, beyond the people, members of the church around you, beyond your house fellowship? Are you touching people that reach farther and farther away from you? And think about our church, Deeper Life Bible Church. Are we willing? Are we ready? Are we prepared? Are we going to pay the price to be able to reach beyond our local church, our district church, our church in the groups, our church in the city? Or are we just satisfied with ourselves? Daniel wasn't. Daniel's ministry reached across to people beyond him. Are we willing to reach our immediate neighborhood all around us? That's what Jesus said. You shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me both where? Again? Jerusalem, and then where? Judea, and then where? Samaria, and now tell me the rest. Until the uttermost part of the earth. Wait a minute, what does that mean? It means that many times we need to release our leaders, our region overseers, our state overseers, our local pastors, our district coordinators, our group coordinators, to go beyond, to reach the uttermost part of the earth. But you know, if we always complain, the coordinator is not there again, the group coordinator is not there again, the region overseer is not there again, our state overseer, national overseer is not there again, where has he gone again? Don't you remember that Daniel was not just ministering to people nearby? Daniel was to reach forth and reach out to the people beyond him. Now again, are we reaching beyond our local church? Are we reaching beyond our denomination? Deeper Life is almost becoming like a denomination. And that means that people know us, they identify us, and they know that the churches are there of Deeper Life all over this nation, all over this continent of Africa, and beyond Africa. But you know what happens to denominations? They settle down. And they think about people like themselves, the people that believe the same doctrine, the people that stand in the same place, the people that drink the same kind of water, and the people that eat the same kind of food, and the people that dress the same way, and the people that make their kind of appearance the same way, they get kind of bottled up, and they narrow down, and they say, you are not like me, I'm not going to talk to you. You are not like me, I'm not going to minister to you. You are not like me, I'm not going to plan anything for you. That wasn't like Daniel. Daniel planned and reached out to people beyond him. Oh, I pray that this church, Deeper Life Bible Church, will not settle down like other denominations. That this great expanding and launching ministry of Daniel, the Lord will give to us as a church in Jesus' name. By the way, that's the reason why we thank God for the transmission, we thank God for the internet. That's why transmission and internet were reaching beyond just Deeper Life. There are some other churches, some other denominations, some other localities, hospitals, and prisons, and student gatherings together that are not related to Deeper Life in name. But we're all studying the Word of God together. This is the will of God. It will continue like this in Jesus' name. And then sometimes we have to pay the price. We have to spend some amount of money so that we're reaching out to people beyond ourselves. This good thing has started. I pray it will continue. Yeah. Then we're going to support the leadership of the church so that by the grace of God, we're going to touch, teach, and transform every life around us and beyond us as well. I thank you. Thank God for your amen. Yeah. We're going to divide the study tonight into three parts. Number one, the politics of the self-willed king. He has a kind of politics. And you see the kind of politics they played by flattery, by deception, by lying, by falsehood, by hypocrisy. Number two, the profanity of the self-centered king. The profanity of the self-centered king. Number three, the perdition, the peril, the destruction of that Satan-controlled king. Let's come back to number one, Daniel chapter 11. I'm reading from verse 21. Daniel 11, verse 21. And in his estate shall stand up a vile person, to whom they shall not give the honor of the kingdom, But he shall come in peaceably and obtain the kingdom by flatteries. Here we're learning something about the coming king. Well, as you look at Daniel, you must understand that this passage we're studying has a